welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear reports from Anna Mateo and Jill Robbins. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's Science Report. We close the show with the next part of our National Parks series. Today, we visit the world-famous Grand Canyon National Park. But first,
a new study finds that the glaciers across the Andes in South America are shrinking at a speed not seen before in the history of human civilization. This discovery surprised scientists. At first, they only planned to study the current conditions of glaciers and how they changed through history. "We thought this result was decades away," said Andrew Gorin. As lead writer of the study, he first thought the results were an accident. But later, he and his team confirmed the results with more samples. Gorin said that the shrinking of glaciers is happening even faster than experts had thought. He and a team of scientists carbon-dated bedrock that had been recently exposed by shrinking glaciers. They measured beryllium-10 and carbon-14 nuclide levels and found that concentrations were nearly zero. He explained that if the rock can see the sky, it collects these nuclides. He added that the decay rate of these nuclides shows that the rock had not been exposed during the Holocene era. This era dates back 11,700 years, but could go back even further. "I would bet my whole life savings that, in fact, these glaciers are smaller than they've been since the last interglacial period," Gorin said. The last interglacial period ended about 115,000 years ago. The study collected data at four glaciers across the Andes. These glaciers make up 99% of the world's tropical glaciers. They are more affected by changing weather because they are regularly at or near freezing point. "We think this is the canary in the coal mine, that this is going to happen everywhere before long, and maybe sooner than we thought," Gorin said. "Canary in the coal mine is an expression that warns of danger. Coal miners would use a canary to tell if the oxygen levels in a coal mine were dangerous." Researchers published the new study in the journal Science on August 1st. I'm Anna Mateo.
Mom Young-sung had low expectations for the subtropical bananas he planted in a community farm in Seoul. He must use a greenhouse for part of the year to protect them from South Korea's cold winters. but warmer temperatures due to climate change have produced a welcome surprise in the form of flowers and fruit. The land area where subtropical crops are grown in South Korea has increased from about 295 hectares in 2021 to 3,306 hectares in 2023. South Korea's State Agricultural Organization, the Rural Development Administration, reports that there are 67 banana farms in the South, and Ma is among a growing number of farmers experimenting with crops usually grown in a warmer climate. I want to try growing other tropical crops too. So, as you can see here, I have planted these papaya trees as well, Ma said, pointing to a small papaya plant. Ma opened up part of his family's farm to people from the city in 2006. He is happy about his small success, but he worries about what it means for the climate. I feel that the climate crisis has become very serious, said Ma, who has been a farmer for 25 years. South Korea lies in the temperate zone and has four seasons, but its climate appears to be getting warmer and wetter throughout the year. The Korea Meteorological Administration reports that since 2012, the average yearly temperature has been continually rising. The average temperature last year of 13.7 degrees Celsius was the highest since its records began in 1973. Rainfall during last year's rainy season was 660.2 millimeters nationwide, nearly two times the 356.7 millimeter annual average figure. Kim Kwang-soo is a professor of agriculture and life sciences at Seoul National University. Kim said South Korea's climate conditions were becoming more like subtropical areas, so it is important for farmers to find the right crop varieties for the climate. Tropical and subtropical fruit are usually expensive in South Korea, so shoppers should welcome the less costly local produce. My kids love bananas, so it would be good if we harvest bananas in this country, said Kim Ji-yoon, who was purchasing imported bananas in a Seoul supermarket. I'm Jill Robbins.
Two American astronauts could remain at the International Space Station, ISS, until February if the spacecraft that transported them cannot be fixed to safely bring them home. The U.S. space agency NASA said last week it had not yet made return plans for astronauts Butch Wilmore and Sonny Williams. The two have been aboard the ISS since June 6th. The American astronauts were expected to stay in space for only a week, but technical issues with the Boeing-built Starliner spacecraft have so far prevented a return trip. The trip that carried Wilmore and Williams was a test flight for Starliner that marked the first time the spacecraft successfully carried astronauts to space. NASA officials held a news conference Wednesday to discuss the ongoing situation with Starliner and the astronauts at the ISS. They said the agency is still working with Boeing to find a solution for the spacecraft's technical difficulties. Investigations have centered on helium leaks and thruster problems with Starliner. But if those issues cannot be resolved in the coming weeks, NASA said it could decide to use SpaceX's Crew Dragon spacecraft to bring the astronauts back to Earth. NASA has been using SpaceX's Crew Dragon to regularly carry astronauts and supplies to the ISS since 2020. If NASA decides to use Crew Dragon, it said it would leave two of four seats open during the spacecraft's next planned launch to the ISS in late September. Wilmore and Williams would then make the trip back to Earth with Crew Dragon. NASA officials told reporters they had brought in additional experts to examine Starliner's leak issues and thruster failures. At the same time, the space agency is looking more closely at SpaceX as a backup solution to get the astronauts back home. The agency's space operations mission chief, Ken Bowersox, said NASA's current thinking is that we could take either path. He added that during a recent meeting, we heard from a lot of folks that had concern and the decision was not clear. NASA has said a final decision should be made by mid-August. Boeing representatives did not take part in the news conference, but the company issued a brief statement Wednesday repeating its position that Starliner could still be fixed to safely transport the astronauts. "We still believe in Starliner's capability and its flight rationale," Boeing said. The Boeing statement said if NASA did decide to change Starliner's mission, the company would take the actions necessary to configure Starliner for an uncrewed return. Steve Stitch is the Commercial Crew Program Manager for NASA. He said the agency was not seriously considering launching a separate SpaceX flight to pick up Wilmore and Williams. Officials said tests run by Boeing and NASA on Earth have reproduced Starliner's thruster problems. This has suggested to engineers a possible issue with the thruster's seals, but Stitch noted it was not clear what is causing the seal issues. The thrusters are important for permitting Starliner to back away from the ISS during its separation operations. At the same time, engineers are seeking to find the cause of helium leaks in the spacecraft's propulsion system. The first leak happened before the launch, but more appeared during flight. Boeing has faced repeated delays as it struggles to complete NASA's flight testing process before it can receive approval to start running official trips to the ISS. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is here now to talk more about his science report. Thanks for joining me, Bryan.
Sure, Ashley. It's good to be here.
This week, you reported on plans NASA is considering for how to bring a pair of astronauts home from the International Space Station. Their return has been delayed because of problems with Boeing's Starliner spacecraft. Have the astronauts themselves made any statements about their current situation?
Yes, so there have been a couple of live news conferences the two astronauts have taken part in during their stay on the ISS, One of those happened just about a month ago, and it was interesting to me that during this conference, the astronauts talked about all the things they were doing to help get things ready for the trip home. So far, we've heard a lot from NASA and Boeing officials about the steps they're taking to fix the spacecraft difficulties, but the astronauts said they are also taking part in these efforts as much as they can every day.
What sorts of things have they said they have been doing?
So one of the things astronaut Sonny Williams said they've been doing is supporting the work of technical teams seeking to resolve Starliner's problems. That effort has involved many people on the ground, but the astronauts aboard the station have also been carrying out safety tests, for example, and coordinating important updates for the spacecraft. Now, Starliner only carried two people in this test flight, but is designed to support four astronauts. So another thing they did was to put two additional astronauts staying at the ISS into the capsule and performed some tests with the spacecraft.
The original plan for these two astronauts was to spend only about a week at the ISS. What are they saying about being delayed there now for over 2 months with no new return date set?
Well, both of the astronauts have said this delay was not totally unexpected, and they've emphasized this was only a test flight, which was carried out, of course, to learn more about the Starliner spacecraft and all flight processes. And the pair also noted that if NASA had found another flight home for them, perhaps with SpaceX's Crew Dragon rocket, that would have been okay, but they also said that would not have been the best solution because there is so much they feel they can do from the ISS to support the current troubleshooting efforts on Earth, and they said so much more is being learned by them remaining in space.
All right. Thanks again for joining me on the podcast, Bryan. And thank you for your science report.
You're very welcome, Ashley. Thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Our national parks journey continues with one of the most popular and beautiful places in America, Grand Canyon National Park in the state of Arizona. The Grand Canyon is one of the seven natural wonders of the world and one of the largest canyons on Earth. It stretches for 450 kilometers. Parts of the canyon are more than 30 kilometers wide and 1 kilometer deep. Many writers have tried to describe the wonder of the Grand Canyon. They use words like mysterious, overpowering, and strange. But it is not possible to put human meaning to such a place. The Grand Canyon truly is beyond words.
Is this your first time at the Grand Canyon?
Yes.
And what do you think? Do you have a few words to describe it?
Beautiful. Amazing.
What do you think of the Grand Canyon?
Oh, very huge and very colorful.
Do you have some words to describe what you're seeing?
Amazing. It's so amazing when I see it. At the first look.
The canyons of America's Southwest are deep, ancient openings in the earth. They look as if they formed as the earth split apart. In reality, rivers formed these canyons. 40 million years ago, the Colorado River began cutting through the area around the present-day Grand Canyon. The river carried dirt and pieces of stone that slowly ate away at the surrounding rock. It left a pathway of enormous rock openings. At the same time, forces deep within the earth pushed up the surrounding land. Rain, snow, ice, wind, and plant roots rubbed away at the top of this new canyon. Below, the river continued to uncover more and more levels of ancient rock. Some of the exposed rocks along the Grand Canyon's walls are nearly 2 billion years old. They are among the oldest rocks on Earth, with many levels of granite, schist, limestone, and sandstone.
The Grand Canyon measures 2,500 meters from the canyon floor to its highest point. Because of its size, the weather at the top of the canyon is often much different from the bottom. On some winter days, for example, you may find cold winds and snow at the top. But at the bottom of the canyon, you may find warm winds and flowers. The Grand Canyon is home to some 2,000 plant species. Some of these species can only be found in the park. The park is also home to more than 370 species of birds, 90 kinds of mammals, and 40 kinds of reptiles. Many of the birds spend their whole lives in the Grand Canyon. Other species depend on the Grand Canyon for food and shelter during large migrations. The Grand Canyon was named a globally important bird area in 2014 because of the role it plays in protecting many species of birds.
Native Americans occupied the Grand Canyon 3,000 years ago. Bones, hair, feathers, and the remains of plants have been found in deep, dry caves high in the rock walls. The Hopi, Paiute, Navajo, and other Native American tribes have all been in the area for at least 700 years. In 1869, American John Wesley Powell explored the Grand Canyon. He recorded much of what we know today about the area. Powell and his group traveled in 4 boats along the Colorado River. He and his group of explorers knew very little about getting over the fast, rocky waters of the Colorado River. In many places, boats could be turned over by giant waves. Soon after they started their journey, Powell's group lost some of its food and equipment. 3 members decided to leave the group. As they walked up and out of the Grand Canyon, they were killed by Native Americans. The rest of Powell's group survived the journey. Starved and tired, Powell and his group reached the end of the canyon. They had traveled by boat down the Colorado for more than 3 months. John Wesley Powell's reports and maps from the trip greatly increased interest in the Grand Canyon. But visitors did not begin to go there in large numbers until 1901. That year, a railway was built that reached the area.
Five million people visit the Grand Canyon every year. The first sight of the canyon can leave visitors speechless. Thank you. Depending on the time of day, the sun lights up the rock walls in red, orange, and golden colors. The bright colors are the result of minerals in the rock. Their appearance changes endlessly with the light, the time of year, and the weather. At sunset, the canyon walls display fiery red and gold hues. Then they take on softer colors of blue, purple, and green. Most visitors walk along paths part way down the canyon. It takes several hours to walk to the bottom, and even longer to climb back up. Some visitors choose to ride mules to the bottom of the canyon. Mules are strong, sturdy animals that look similar to horses. Visitors can also explore the Grand Canyon in other ways. Hundreds of thousands of people see the canyon by air each year. They pay a helicopter or airplane pilot to fly them above and around the canyon. Thousands of people every year choose to explore the Grand Canyon by boat from the Colorado River. These trips last 1 to 3 weeks.
Most people who come to the Grand Canyon National Park visit an area known as the South Rim. That area has shuttle buses that take visitors to overlooks. Fewer people see the canyon from the North Rim. The North Rim is less than 20 kilometers across the canyon from the South Rim, but visitors must drive more than 350 kilometers by car from the South Rim to access the North Rim. Visitors can also see the Grand Canyon from a huge glass walkway called the Skywalk. The Skywalk is on the Hualapai Indian Reservation in the western part of the canyon. The Hualapai Indians built it to increase tourism at the reservation. It opened in 2007. The Skywalk extends more than 20 meters from the canyon's rim. It is suspended more than 1,200 meters above the bottom of the canyon and is shaped like a giant horseshoe. Many call the Skywalk an engineering wonder, but others have criticized the Skywalk and its development. They say it reduces the enjoyment of nature in the Grand Canyon. For visitors hoping to get a view of the entire Grand Canyon, they will have to travel well beyond the state of Arizona. The only place to see the entire canyon at once is from outer space. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Jonathan Evans.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.